He's alone now, asleep. The grizzly waits out the long winter months beneath a canopy of white. Ridges and breaks of snow, capped mountains shelter him from Alaska's harshest bite. The long winter days pass. Patiently, he awaits the thaw. At last, the sun pours its life into a frozen vastness. Rivers rise. Lakes clear their shells of ice, welcoming the fowl to their spring nesting ground. Once again, the rivers sparkle with life, pouring clear water toward the sea. Below, thousands of salmon pass their way north. Spring has arrived, and with it, the arrival of the forest dwellers, eager to begin anew. And with their arrival, so come the hunters. I too am a hunter. It's here that I return to play out the drama that man has rehearsed for a million years. For I am a spear hunter, primitive yet lethal. Harvesting the flesh and hide of Alaska's greatest predators. Foraging as my ancestors have for a thousand centuries.
Wow.
Facing my own fears while facing the beast. I now search the vastness, waiting and wondering where he might be. North America's man-eater. Massive, smart, elusive. He's out there. He's waiting for me. The Grizz. Day 21. In the wee hours of the morning, it's no grizzly, but a big black bear. And he's approaching the bait. He will feed camp, and after 3 weeks, if I'm lucky, it'll boost morale. The spear is lethal. And in seconds, it is over.
This is what they call a chocolate phase bear or a cinnamon bear. And look how thick and long the hide is on this bear. That's an Alaskan spring bear. Older bear. They don't get as big as they might like in North Carolina, but because the growing season up here is a lot shorter, that they only have so much time when they're out of the den to feed. But you can see the bear has quite a bit of fat still on him from winter's hibernation, so he's healthy. Bear populations near heavy bathing zones, you'd think that they would be lower because they're all killed, but in actuality, where there's a lot of bear baiting going on, the bear population is higher, the bears are healthier, and the reason for that is, what they believe or theorize is, a bear that comes out of hibernation is really struggling at that point physically. They have to feed and they have to find food. In years where there's not a lot of food, if the fish aren't running, if the berries aren't ripe, if the grasses aren't as green as possible, they can come to bear baits. So what happens is they're healthier, fatter, and they have more cubs the following spring. And so, yeah, we shoot a few of them, but for every bear we shoot, there's a half a dozen that we don't shoot. And so those bears go into the next hibernation very healthy, and they have more cubs. And it's just a testament to hunting and the benefits of hunting and how hunting is a part of the cycle of life. Okay, so this is kind of home away from the forest. And every couple days we try to get back here and relax and rejuvenate from the long hours of hunting. And I am with the camp cook, Jerry. Jerry, what do you got there, hon?
Porcupine.
I've been hitting on her all week, but she's not very receptive since she's, I think, happily married, but she likes her dog more than me, it seems like. But anyway, Jerry's a great cook, and this is the hind quarter off of my porcupine, and you can see that it's a beautiful texture of meat. And here's the front legs. When I come to camp, generally the things that I hunt, I like to try to at least eat them. And I've always heard the porcupine tastes good, so we're going to find out. Now, how are you going to cook them, Jerry? What's the plan?
I am going to fry them in bacon grease after putting them in flour and seasoning.
Okay.
And we are going to add mushrooms.
And I just came across a pleasant surprise. Here I am in Alaska. It's end of June, and I'm trying to get some food while the mosquitoes eat on me. But I'm sure you recognize this. Morels. And they grow in the forest here where it's moist and where there's been some sunlight.
They're athletic foot till it falls off the bone. With rice.
You could eat baboon or anything with that recipe, I bet. In a few hours, it'll be done. So.
Alright, he'll let you know how it turned out.
Alright, Jerry. Thank you.
I'm Tim Wells, the Slock Master, and I use Morel Targets, Carbon Express Arrows. I buy from Bass Pro and use cold steel knives. I light them up with Luminox and wear Mossy Oak camo. I kill animals with Grim Reapers and lure them near with Killer Gear decoys. I use Muzzy for big fish. and put their meat in canyon coolers. My Oneida bow goes with me in an SKB case. I shoot Umarex air guns and fish from tracker boats. Fox Pro is my go-to call, and I drive a Ford truck, because Ford trucks are tough. I've caught a chocolate bear hunting along the cliffs of the Copper River. I'm trying to intercept him before he drops into heavy cover. I'm back to the tree where the big female had made me spend the night. Only this time, a boar has arrived. Only 6 days, 9 hours a day. Finally, this was my chance. He came all the way in, then camped where I can't get a throw. Come on, big fella, one more step. At this point, my heart was about to leave my chest. I was poised to strike, and the bear was nearly in perfect position. When suddenly, a second bear growls to my right. And when I looked back, the boar was gone. It was then I could see why. An even bigger boar was coming down the trail, headed straight for the bait. As he came my way, I figured I'd let him get his nose in the bait, then settle in before I slocked him. But grizzlies are smarter than black bears. He no sooner arrived and something tipped him off. It was over as fast as it began. I never even got to raise my spear. Day 27, I'd set for 12 hours straight. In the wee hours of the morning, I got down out of the stand and began to gather up my cameras. When suddenly, I've caught movement, and it's coming my way. It's a big grizzly. He's circling the bait. I've dropped into the stream just below. and now I'm waiting 4 yards from the bait. Methodically, he moves side to side. Obviously, he knew I was there. He vanished into heavy cover. Still, I knew he was close. I could feel it. The big grizzly is circling in from the left, when I think he's on my right. Once again, I have failed. I had quit 5 minutes too early. He would have walked directly under my tree stand. After predator calling, I've drawn a chocolate bear in from above. I was hoping they'd come up the mountain to me, when suddenly, he's directly over my head.
Back half of the squirrel.
Young.
It's kind of like a squirrel combo. Squirrel, rabbit, onion, bacon, seasoning. Then this goes in the oven next. Is that right?
We will cook it in a Dutch oven.
Dutch oven. Okay. All right. We're getting close to dinner time. I like that. Well, here we are. Having a rabbit and my vegetables right before I go after a brown bear. Delicious.
The vastness of Alaska seems lonely at times, yet peaceful. As in the days before, my guide jumps from the boat, then goes to check trail cameras to see if anything's visited the bait. I wait in the boat to reduce the amount of scent we spread near the bait. The report is good, for they have arrived. Alaska's monsters. At 3 a.m., 2 days before, they were here. I grab my climber and head in for the night. This night started out no different than many others. Lonely and quiet. a resting forest all around me. Then, in the wee hours of the morning, it all changed. He came silent. His blonde coat was ghostly as he lumbered my way.
Mixing everything together. It's kind of like a Alaskan porridge, right?
Well, I wouldn't go that far.
Here I am with my master grizzly bear guide. Been slow the last 2 days, so he keeps his clients happy. And I'm happy, Aaron.